Hello and welcome into LMU Community TV News. I'm Ashley Hurley. Thank you for joining us. A former narcotics detective with the Claiborne County Sheriff's Office is facing trial following an incident with a known drug dealer in June of this year. 49-year-old Robert Chadwell was indicted by the Claiborne County Grand Jury in its December session. A true bill was returned for Chadwell on one count of extortion and robbery by a public servant, charges that he gained while a deputy with the Sheriff's Office. The incident prompted the drug dealer to file a complaint to his attorney, followed by the attorney contacting the Sheriff's Office and then the 8th Judicial District Attorney General's Office. The Tennessee Bureau of Investigation investigated the situation that led to Chadwell's arrest during an undercover sting operation. According to an affidavit filed by a special agent with the TBI, the former officer was allegedly watched on June 18th accepting $2,000 in cash from the drug dealer with the agreement that Chadwell would provide additional money back at a later date. The affidavit continues that the money was in exchange for Chadwell using discretion as a law enforcement officer to not pursue criminal drugs and firearms related charges against the drug dealer. Special agents arrested Chadwell, who was booked into the Claiborne County Jail with a $500,000 secured bond. When the situation occurred, Claiborne County Sheriff David Ray terminated Chadwell's position with the Sheriff's Department. A woman is charged with four counts in connection with a bomb threat made to the Claiborne County Jail last Thursday night. Sheriff David Ray said that a call came into the jail around 9 o'clock, and the woman stated that someone would be coming out there with a bomb to, quote, blow the place up. Sheriff Ray said a man, who was later identified as the woman's boyfriend, also called to tell officials who was calling in the alleged threat and that other calls were made that night. According to reports, activity was shut down at the Justice Center and the building was secured and traffic around the area was stopped on the road in front of the Justice Center. The jail is located inside of the Justice Center, prompting the shutdown. Detective Tim Shrout was the lead investigator that night, who confirmed in a news release that the Justice Center was sealed off and all roads were blocked while a search of the area was conducted. It was determined that during one of the calls, the woman's real name was actually used, and that is how they were able to locate her. Lieutenant Stephen Hurley and deputies Chris Cardwell and Brian Hubbard took Hazel Irene Gray and Justin Pridemore into custody at a residence in the Gowans Chapel community. According to the release, officers determined during the interrogation that Gray had allegedly placed the threatening call to the Justice Center, saying that she was strapped with an explosive device and was en route to blow up the Justice Center. The entire incident was completed by approximately 2 that morning, and no evacuation of the Justice Center was needed, and no device was found during a thorough search. 20-year-old Gray is charged with hoax device, false report, interference with government operations, and tampering with evidence. She is being held in the Claiborne County Jail on a secured $100,000 bond, and her court appearance is scheduled for January 6th of 2016. Claiborne County Office of Emergency Management and Homeland Security was on scene to assist, along with local police departments and the Tennessee Highway Patrol. Units from Knox County were on standby, but they were not needed at the scene. The man accused of murdering a Campbell County woman entered a plea deal last week. 44-year-old Lonnie Van, a former La Follette Middle School teacher, pled guilty to second-degree murder, kidnapping, aggravated robbery, tampering with evidence, and assault. Van said that he was pleading guilty because he is guilty. According to the district attorney's office, Van took a La Follette Middle School student to a church, tried to kiss her, then destroyed the video in October of 2013. The state also said he robbed a family in Deerfield in December 2014. Van was added to the Tennessee Bureau of Investigation's top 10 most wanted after he was wanted in connection to that robbery. In December of 2014, Van killed Rhonda Daugherty. According to the DA's office, her body has not been found. The state did bring forward evidence in court that may shed some light on her death. The state showed the judge surveillance pictures of Van in the Clinton Walmart on December 1st. It showed him purchasing duffel bags, gloves, and duct tape. The next day, he is seen at the Lowe's on Clinton Highway buying a Christmas tree bag and center blocks. This is the same day that Daugherty went missing. A receipt for these items was found in a fishing boat at Sugar Hollow Marina on Norris Lake. A private area of the lake was searched, but the body was never found. On December 12th of 2014, Van was arrested in Myrtle Beach. Authorities searched his car and found a duffel bag and zip ties with Daugherty's DNA on it. The sheriff vows to keep looking for Daugherty's body. In the plea deal, Van agreed to serve 40 years. The district attorney says Van will be at least 75 years old before he is eligible for parole. The judge accepted the plea deal but said to the victim's family that he understands the justice system cannot mend all hearts. The second reading of a consideration of an ordinance regulating the sale of alcoholic beverages within the city limits of Middlesboro was temporarily postponed at the city council meeting. The council wants to clarify questions that members had concerning the first reading of the consideration of the ordinance at last month's meeting. Mayor Bill Kelly reported that the city attorney is working on the issues to ensure that everything is clarified before the second reading of the proposed ordinance. The mayor stated that he does expect to have answers for those questions by next week. As soon as the issues are resolved, a special called board meeting is expected to be held, as opposed to waiting until the regularly scheduled meeting to conduct the second reading. The special called meeting would allow the ordinance to be in place as quickly as possible. According to the mayor and members of the council, several individuals are already asking about the ordinance in preparation for the sale of alcoholic beverages. The job description of the alcoholic beverage coordinator was also discussed, but it will not be completed until after the ordinance is approved. Following the announcement that Harlan native Jordan Smith is the winner of Season 9 of The Voice, Harlan is preparing to celebrate his return home. A parade celebrating Jordan was scheduled for 2:30 on Monday in Harlan that began in front of the Harlan Elementary School, traveled down Central Street to Cumberland Avenue. The parade ended at the intersection of Main and Clover at the Harlan Center, where a homecoming celebration kicked off at 4 o'clock and Jordan was available for autographs after the celebration at 6 o'clock during a meet and greet. The meet and greet took place in the upper level of the Harlan Center. Going into the live results finale, Smith held half of the top 10 spots on the Voice iTunes charts and had 10 singles ranking on the Voice chart. Throughout the show, Smith remained humble as the judges continued to remark his flawless performances. Last week, we spoke with a Harlan community member who has a very special message for Jordan.
All right, this is Ashley Hurley with LMU Community TV News, and I'm here with
Andrea Madden.
What do you want to say to Jordan when he wins?
Go, Jordan. Congratulations from Harlan County. We're so proud of you. You have made us so happy, and you're an awesome person. Everything you sang was just awesome. No matter what they threw at you, you had it, and we're so proud of you.
All right, you heard it first. Right here with Ashley Hurley with LMU Community TV News.
It was announced last Tuesday during the finale show that Smith's YouTube performances on the show had approximately 55 million views to date. Smith was the only contestant remaining on Coach Adam Levine's team, and the coach obviously proud of his performances and accomplishments throughout the show. You can continue to follow Smith's progress by liking his Facebook page. Well, coming up after the break, we've got information to keep you and your family safe this holiday season, so keep it right here on LMU Community TV News.
We're leaving.
Most party fouls are pretty dumb. But if you decide to drink and drive underage, you could lose your license and your freedom. Underage drinking and driving, the ultimate party foul.
Look at you. You're at the top of your game. At work or at play, you're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Oh, hey, she's cute. Nice going, man. Things are going great for you. You've earned a night out. Good drinks, good friends. Yeah, we can go ahead and call this a good night. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. not smart. Yeah, I saw that coming. Say goodbye to her. Ouch, that'll hurt your bank account. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. I hope you like eating frozen dinners. Alone. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
Hey, did you know 2.4 million loving cats and dogs in shelters and rescues need our help to find a home? Let's go to the shelterpetproject.org and meet if you are in a shelter near you. Harlow. Oh, she's one great listener who loves to hear all your stories. My kind of cat. Cerulo is a sweet, goofy boy who's eager to please. Sounds just like another dog I know. So go to the shelterpetproject.org, search your local shelters and rescues, and go for a cuddle with your next best friend. Adopt.
The Kentucky State Police have collected more than 123 tons of food for families in need throughout the state. The food was collected during what they call the Cram the Cruiser event. It is given to shelters, food banks, and churches. The program began in 2010, and the agency has contributed more than 750,000 pounds of food. The amount of food collected this year is reported to be a record, and it is from all the generosity of citizens and businesses. Throughout the campaign, the state police, post, and commercial vehicle enforcement regions have a friendly competition to see which of them can collect the most food. This year's leader was the Henderson Post, which collected 44,670 pounds of food. That is awesome. Well, the National Fire Protection Association wants to make sure that you and your families are safe during the holidays, and they recently laid out some tips for Christmas tree safety. If you have a live tree inside your home, they want you to make sure that it is continuously watered and does not dry out, because once the tree becomes dry, it becomes dangerous. Additionally, if you have an artificial tree, make sure it is labeled, certified, or identified by the manufacturer as fire retardant. Placement of your tree is also important. Before placing the tree on the stand, cut at least 2 inches from the base of the trunk. Make sure it is at least 3 feet away from any heat source, such as fireplaces, radiators, candles, heat vents, or even lights. Make sure the tree is also not blocking an exit. When lighting the tree, use lights that have the label of an independent testing laboratory. Now, some lights are for only use indoor or outdoor, but not both, so be sure you read that label. Replace any string of lights with worn or broken cords or even loose bulb connections. Connect no more than 3 strands of mini string sets and a maximum of 50 with bulbs. They also encourage families to develop and practice a home fire escape plan with everyone inside your home. Your plan should always include 2 ways out of every room and a designated meeting place outside where everyone can be accounted for. And don't forget to install smoke alarms on every level of your home and test those monthly. The National Park Service turns 100 years old in 2016 and wants everyone to celebrate with them. All national parks will waive their entrance fees on 16 special days in 2016. The entrance fee-free days for 2016 are January 18th, April 16th through 24th, August 25th through 28th, September 24th, and November 11th. To honor the National Park Service Centennial, the National Park Foundation has joined the National Park Service to launch a public engagement campaign called Find Your Park to help all Americans discover all the things that the national parks can be. Visit findyourpark.com for a list of centennial special events across the country and learn how to discover, explore, recreate, and be inspired, or simply just have fun in the national parks. More than 20,000 National Park Service employees care for America's 409 national parks and work with communities across the nation to help preserve local history and create close-to-home recreational opportunities. You can also visit www.nps.gov or visit their Facebook and Twitter pages to find out more about your local national parks. Lincoln Memorial University will host its annual FAFSA Frenzy and Recruitment Fair from 10 to 1 on Saturday, January 9th at the LMU Cedar Bluff Extended Learning Site in Knoxville. LMU staff will assist families of college-bound students to complete the free application for federal student aid. The FAFSA is the federally required form for students seeking financial aid that includes grants, scholarships, and loans throughout the nation. LMU Executive Director and Financial Aid Officers and other staff will be available to assist with applications, review completed forms, and upload applications. Research shows that families often list high cost as the main barrier to college. Even though tens of millions of dollars in various forms of financial aid is available every year, the FAFSA form is used at colleges, universities, and technical schools nationwide. Students should complete their FAFSA as close to January 1st as possible to get the maximum aid available, even if the student has not selected a college. Students and families should bring with them completed 2014 IRS 1040 tax returns, W-2 statements, and other 2015 income and benefit information, current bank statements, untaxed income records for the previous year, driver's licenses, and alien registration cards. This information is helpful to complete the FAFSA, but it is not required to attend. Well, if you were looking for a furry friend to get or give for Christmas, we've got this week's Pet of the Week from the Claiborne Animal Shelter. And after this, Adam Haley will bring you your sports update. Everyone, and welcome into this week's Pet of the Week segment. Today, Liza from the Claiborne Animal Shelter brought with her Dusty. Tell us a little bit about Miss Dusty.
Well, she is just about a year old, and she's a corgi mix, and we're not sure what she's mixed with. Something really energetic. And she is as sweet as she can be.
Yes.
And as you can see, she has a lot of energy.
Yes.
And so she would be good to go to a family where the family has a lot of energy.
Right.
And I think she'll settle down once, you know, if she gets out and really runs,
yeah,
she won't have all this energy. She goes for long walks at the shelter, but she's somebody that needs a lot of room to move.
Okay, tell us a little bit about the corgi and how they need to be cared for.
A corgi actually is a herding dog.
Okay.
And a fun fact about them is they're the breed that's favored by the royal family.
Mm-hmm.
Queen Elizabeth
yes.
loves her corgis. And they're very loyal. They're very dedicated to their family.
Mm-hmm.
They make a wonderful pet.
Yeah.
And I think she would be certainly good around kids, not little kids, because she might knock them over.
Right.
Because she's so energetic.
She almost knocked me over.
Yeah. But, see, as you can see, once she settles down,
right.
I'm rubbing her tummy right now. That's a magic.
Yes.
A magic thing. She loves a tummy rub. She's just a sweet little girl.
Her eyes are so cute. They just look at you.
Yeah.
And she's
look
just
at
like,
the camera.
Take me home.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so
give me kisses. She gives kisses.
If someone is interested in adopting Miss Dusty, tell them how they can go about doing that.
Okay. What they can do is go online to claiborneanimalshelter.com. We have an adoption application online. Or they can come into the shelter and fill out an application and to have Dusty take them for a walk
mm-hmm.
and meet her. She really is. She's very sweet.
She is.
She's not presenting well today because she's too excited.
Oh, right.
All right, so now she's somebody that, so people can come in and fill out an application and just so they know, we do a background check
mm-hmm.
on them to make sure that their previous pets have gone to the veterinarian on a regular basis.
Okay.
So she's ready to roll, right, Dusty? Yes. Okay. Now we're gonna see if I let go of her leash.
Okay.
What's gonna happen?
Okay.
She might knock the camera down.
All right.
Okay. You ready,
Here
Dusty?
Go. If you are interested in making Dusty a part of your family, you can check her out online or you can visit the Claiborne Animal Shelter Monday through Friday, and you can make her a part of your family.
And we're open Saturdays from 10 until 2.
There you go. 10 until 2.
There's one thing you can never have sex without.
It's not something you buy.
Or something you take.
In fact, there's only one way to get it.
It has to be given to you, freely.
It's consent.
Because sex without it isn't sex.
It's rape. Consent.
If you don't get it, you don't get it.
It's on us to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Hey, Gabby, how you doing? How was the play date and sleepover?
Dad, it was great.
Awesome. Okay, I'm on my way.
Hey, guys, what are you doing?
We're going swimming.
We're going biking.
Yeah.
I'll see you in a little bit, guys. I love you.
Hi, babe. How was school today?
Hi, Dad. It was great.
Okay, honey. I'll be home soon. Remember, you're never too far away from your kids to be a dad. Reach out and take a second to check in, because sometimes the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Alvin and the Chipmunks want to remind you, bacteria can hide in food and make you ill.
Wow.
But you can keep bacteria from ruining your day with four simple steps. Clean.
I'm waiting for the rinse cycle.
Separate. Cook.
Fire in the hole.
And chill.
We chipmunks are notoriously tidy.
Check your steps. The road trip to food safety starts at foodsafety.gov.
There are 16 million children struggling with hunger in America. That's 1 in 5 daughters, sons, neighbors, and classmates who don't know where their next meal is coming from. Yet billions of pounds of good food go to waste every year. It's time we do something about it. Feeding America is a nationwide network of food banks that helps provide meals to millions of kids and families in need. Visit feedingamerica.org to help them feed even more. Together, we can solve hunger. Together, we're feeding America.
Welcome back. The LMU basketball team spent this past weekend in Newberry, South Carolina, where they faced the Wolves of Newberry College in conference action. The ladies were going in still with a nasty taste in their mouth after their loss to Wingate earlier in the week. The story of the game with Newberry would be rebounding. LMU pulled down 32 first-half rebounds, 10 of which came on the offensive side of the court. That stat, along with shooting nearly 42% from the field, helped LMU run out to a 35-24 halftime lead. LMU will continue their dominance, leading by 19 after the third quarter. Newberry would make a run late, but the deficit was too much for the Wolves, and LMU picked up another conference win, 68-56. Megan Pittman led LMU with 22 points and 15 rebounds. The Lady Rail Splitters out-rebounded the Wolves 52-28, and LMU had 19 offensive rebounds that led to 28 second-chance points. The Lady Rail Splitters are now 7-4 overall and 4-2 in conference as they'll break for the holidays. They'll be back in action on January 6th at Mars Hill. The LMU men were looking to continue their winning streak into the holiday break, but standing in their way was the high-powered Newberry offense that was averaging 92.5 points per game coming in. Jalen Steele got the scoring started with a fast-break jumper, and that would start to a career day for Steele. The first 8 minutes of the game was back and forth until a three-pointer by Tim Pierce and a layup by Paul Woodson started a 19-6 run for the Rail Splitters that would push them to a 67-46 halftime lead. Newberry came out in the second half and started chipping away at LMU's lead, getting as close as 7 points with 7 minutes left before another Steele three-pointer broke Newberry's spirit. LMU would move to the win 115-94. Steele led LMU with a career-high 40 points. The Rail Splitters shot an amazing 65.7% from the field and hit 18 three-pointers in the game. 10 of those threes came from Jalen Steele, and those is now an LMU record for the most threes in one game. The LMU men will go into the holiday break at 10-1 overall and 6-0 in conference play. The men will take a short holiday break before traveling to Louisville, Kentucky for a battle with 19th-ranked Bellarmine on January 2nd. Now that's all for sports, but stay tuned after the break as Joseph Lewis will let us know exactly how much money the new Star Wars movie brought in this past weekend when he brings you the box office report. When we return here on LMU Community TV News.
Short ride from your neighborhood to your naturehood. Find fun activities to do, like boating and biking, or camping and hiking, plus much more. To find a neighborhood park or green space near you, visit discovertheforest.org.
Hello, I'm Joseph Lewis, bringing you all the latest information in the world of movies. Tops at the box office this weekend were led, surprising absolutely no one, by Star Wars: The Force Awakens, which took the multiplexes by storm domestically and worldwide. Between early Thursday night screenings and the three-day weekend, it accumulated a grand total of $238 million, instantly setting the record for the biggest opening weekend of all time, knocking out the $208 million record scored by Jurassic World this past summer by a margin of $30 million. The Force Awakens also easily took an additional $279 million worldwide, bringing its four-day total to a whopping $517 million. In addition to these numbers, the amount of other records taken by Star Wars over the 4 days is staggering. As of right now, the film holds the record for the largest single-day gross ever, with $120 million from this past Friday alone. It also made more money from Thursday previews than any other film in the past, its $57 million take beating the $43 million pulled by Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows Part II back in 2011. For more information on the film's debut performance and to continue following its success throughout the holiday movie season, be sure to visit www.boxofficemojo.com. Following at number two by a wide margin was Alvin and the Chipmunks: The Road Trip, drawing only $14 million over the weekend, by far the worst opening for a Chipmunks film thus far, falling short even of the $23 million opening secured by the third film, subtitled Chipwrecked, 4 years ago to the week. And rounding out the top three was the Tina Fey and Amy Poehler starring comedy Sisters, starting its run with $13 million. Although its reception with critics and audiences has been largely positive thus far, the glut of other comedies being released in the coming weeks could cause Sisters to become lost in the holiday movie shuffle. Meanwhile, The Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 2 experienced a significant drop, taking $5 million toward a total domestic gross of $254 million. After 31 days of release, it continues to fall short of Mockingjay Part 1's gross by roughly $20 million and seems destined to conclude its run as the lowest and slowest grossing entry into the wildly popular action-adventure franchise. Other current releases, including Creed, The Good Dinosaur, Krampus, and In the Heart of the Sea, are all on the downswing, with The Force Awakens both paving the way for and setting itself up to dominate next week's major Christmas releases, which include the latest film from cinematic master Quentin Tarantino entitled The Hateful Eight, a bloodthirsty, snowbound western starring Samuel L. Jackson, Kurt Russell, and Jennifer Jason Leigh, among others. Joy, the latest dramedy from Silver Linings Playbook and American Hustle director David O. Russell, once again teaming up with Jennifer Lawrence, Bradley Cooper, and Robert De Niro. Daddy's Home, a ribald comedy starring Will Ferrell and Mark Wahlberg with a surprising PG-13 rating. Point Break, a remake of the early 90s action classic starring the great Edgar Ramirez, who also appears in Joy. Concussion, a biographical drama headlined by Will Smith as a forensic pathologist whose research causes major problems for the NFL, and the nationwide expansion of The Big Short, Adam McKay's comedy about the 2008 financial crisis, featuring an all-star cast including Christian Bale, Steve Carell, Ryan Gosling, and Brad Pitt. That's what audiences have to look forward to in the coming weeks, and that's all for this year in the world of movies. I'm Joseph Lewis.
Well, that is going to do it for LMU Community TV News for today. So, what's your tagline?
I'm Adam Haley. Thank you for joining us. We shall see you not this year, but in 2016.
That's right. I'm so excited. Christmas break, Santa Claus, elves.
And no snow.
You took the words right out of my mouth.
No snow.
Have a happy 72-degree Christmas, everyone, with umbrellas and rain boots. No sleds or anything like that. So have a great Christmas and a wonderful New Year, and we will see you at the beginning of the year.
Absolutely.
All right. Bye.